going to talk about the functional generalizations and applications of all things covariance level. Okay. I made this change because on this special occasion, I would like to choose a topic that is of interest to everyone. So I would like to choose a topic that is at the intersection of statistics, actuarial science, and most importantly, for teaching. Because today we have some students, they are recognized some familiar faces of my students who got tortured by me last semester. So today's topic, Hopkins covariance lemma, will be a technical result in statistics, in actuarial science, and I will show that it has the potential to contribute to actuarial science teaching. So what exactly is Hopkins lemma? So in the literature, we have many different kinds of covariance formulas serving different purposes. So what Hopkins formula tries to do is to express the covariance between two random variables, x and y, the square integral, as an integral comparison between the joint CDF and the product of the marginal CDF. Or we can use, or we can change CDF to survival function. So we have joint survival function and the marginal survival function. Now this formula is good because it separates the joint distribution function from the marginal distribution function. Okay, so it is a perfect tool for the study of dependent structures and stochastic models. Okay, so we can treat the dependent part and the marginal part separate. Now in the literature, there are at least two applications of the Hopkins lemma. Okay, the first application is to determine the dependent structures that optimize the covariance when we fix the marginal distributions. Okay, so we go back to this formula. So when the marginal distributions are fixed, so the marginal terms are fixed, so what we can really vary will be the joint CDF or the joint survival function. So if we want to optimize the left-hand side, then what we can do is to optimize the joint CDF and the joint survival function. And the answer to this question is quite simple. The maximum covariance will be achieved by the cumulotonic random factor. The minimum covariance will be obtained by so-called counter monotonic random factor. Now another application of Hopkins lemma is to identify some classes of bivariate distributions with a definite sign on their covariance. And we would like to do this without any integration. The integration in general is not easy. So we go back to the formula again. Now if a random factor satisfies the property that the integrand is always non-negative. And in the literature, we call this kind of random factor a positively quotient dependent. That means the integrand is always non-negative. Then it follows directly from the formula. The integration of something which is always non-negative, the covariance must be non-negative. And the opposite is also true. For negatively quotient dependent random factors, then covariance must be negative. Now what I'm going to do today is to extend Hopkins lemma from the covariance between x and y to the covariance between a function of x and a function of y. Okay, so here f and g are some good functions satisfying some particular properties. Now in the literature, there was some attempt to generalize this formula. Okay, so in these two research papers, we have a formula for strictly monotone functions. Okay. And the formula is simple. If we simply replace the differential dx dy to dfx and dgy. Okay. So we go from Lambix integrals to Lambix usual integrals. Now of course, if f and g are the identity functions, of course this formula will simply reduce to the old case, the original Hopkins formula. So from dfx, dgy to just dx, dy. Okay. So this formula makes perfect sense, intuitively clear, almost correct, okay. But in general it is not true. Okay. So in this talk, I will explain why this formula is generally not true, and then I will provide the correct formulation of the functional generalization. Okay, because of time constraint, I will only deal with the monotone case. Okay, if we have additional conditions on these two functions, then of course we will have some simplifications. And hopefully I will have time to go over one application of the original formula and also application of the generalized formula in the context of the practical evaluation of covariance. Now let's see why the previous formula in the literature is generally not correct. So from real analysis, we know that Lambic-Sturgeon's integrals are defined with respect to only left continuous or right continuous non-decreasing integrators. Okay, so if you just write dfx dgy, in general those integrals are not defined. So here's a very brief recap between the relationship between real functions, non-decreasing real functions, and measures on the real line. Okay, so if f is the right continuous function, okay, then we can define a measure on the real line through this assignment. Okay, so the measure of this kind of semi-open interval is simply the difference between fb and fa. For left continuous function, we have a similar formula. But this time the semi-open interval is changed. Okay, this time the semi-open interval is closed on the left, but open on the right. In the previous case, it is open on the left, but closed on the right. Okay, so there is a subtle difference. Okay, but this subtle difference will be material to a correct formulation of the generalized formula. So here it is correct and generalized formula. Okay, so here we continue to assume f and g to be non-decreasing functions, and it turns out that the formula in high generality turns out to comprise four terms, okay, four double Lambic-Sturgeon's integrals with different integrators. Okay, and these integrators are obtained by decomposing these functions f and g into their right continuous components, so fr and gr, and the left continuous components, fl and gl. Okay, so different integrators and also different integrals. Okay. But despite the ugly appearance of this formula, you can see some regularity. Okay, so sharp inequalities always go with right continuous integrators. Okay, strict inequalities always go with left continuous integrators. And this has to do with our previous definition, the subtle definition about which side is open, which side is closed. I don't think I have time for sketch proof. I'll go to an example. And this example also shows why the formula in the literature is not correct. It is a simple case when f and g are just non-decreasing integrator functions. One is left continuous, one is right continuous. Okay, so we apply this formula, when f and g are just integrator functions, then we will just have one term. Okay, we have just one term because these two functions are already right continuous or left continuous. So there's no need to do any decomposition. So just one term. And because they are integrator functions, so the induced measure of these two functions will be simply the Dirac measure. Dirac measure at these two points, C and D. Okay. So integration with respect to Dirac measures means evaluating the integrand precisely at these two points. So we simply change x and y to C and D. Okay, that will be the final answer. Okay, but notice that for the y event, we have a greater than or equal to. Okay, so not a strict inequality. Okay, if we use the formula in the literature, we will simply have y strictly greater than d, and y strictly greater than d. Okay. So which one is correct? Okay, I think my formula is correct because I used what I learned from first year and second year probability as so covariance of two random variables will be the expectation of the product. So this is the product and the product of the marginal means. So expectation of indicator function just probability. And here I can find sharp inequality for the y event. Okay, so the type of inequalities in the integrand indeed matters in general. Let's come to the application. And the application will be introduced by means of a quiz. Okay. So the quizzes and exams will be a best way for people to to learn. And this quiz comes in the form of a sample exam question in 20S182 or LiveGone 2 or the MLC exam of the Society of Actuaries. If some students are going to take MLC exam next Tuesday, or we take MLC exam next Tuesday. Okay. Now the setting is quite simple. Here we have a common shock model for two persons. And TX and TY are the future lifetime random variables. C will be the common shock random variable. And we are interested in calculating the covariance between TX and TY in the presence of the common shock. Now the standard way to do this question, as we learned from the exam syllabus, is to use the standard formula, the expectation of product minus the product of the marginal means. But in this case, the calculation of the movements is not easy because the distribution of this random vector is rather complex. It has an absolutely continuous component. Now the joint PDF does not exist everywhere. It exists on R2 minus the diagonal. Okay, so in that subset, we can do differentiation. We use differentiation to recapture, retrieve the joint PDF in these two forms. Another component of the distribution will be the singularly continuous component because of the presence of the common shock. Okay. So when we do the integration, when we do the movement calculation, we have to take these two components into account. Okay. So when we really do the integration, so for the absolutely continuous component, we do integration. ST and then integrate over the joint PDF. Okay, that is the first term. And then we also have to account for simultaneous steps because of the common shock. Okay, that will be the second integral. Okay. Now because S and T, the integration variables appears here, okay, and joint PDF is of this form. Okay, so when you really do the integration, you perform really ordered integration. Okay, we will come into some rather tedious integration, okay, involving integration by parts, integration by substitution. Okay, this is integration. Okay, after integration is done, we also have to do some very tedious algebraic manipulations. Okay, this is doable as a homework question, but not doable as an exam. Now, this is what a hardworking and honest student would do. What a lazy instructor, a lazy and dishonest instructor, dishonest because he makes use of secret weapons, not in the exam syllabus. So this instructor will use Hopkins formula. It directly calculates covariance. They no need to go through the product movement. They just calculate covariance. Covariance as an integral of the joint PDF, joint survival function, and the joint and the marginal survival function. And these two quantities can be captured directly from the model setup, just found by definition to be these two expressions. And here the integration variables S and T, it just appears in exponent. Okay, so when we really do the integration, it will be very simple. So no integration by parts, no integration by substitution. So if we really do the work, a very simple work, then we will get this final nice answer. Okay. Now the reason why using Hopkins level is that simple, the reason is the Hopkins formula conveniently sidestep the intricacy arising from the singular component of the joint distribution. Okay. And in fact, this formula is applicable to all kinds of random vectors. Okay. Discrete, absolutely continuous, singularly continuous, or a mixture of these types of distributions. It always works. Now, another application of the Hopkins lemma, but this time for a generalized version, we can calculate something like the covariance generating function. And we all know about movement generating function. We can also calculate covariance generating function. Covariance between the exponent of future lifetime. Okay, so a direct application, we can get this nice formula. I call this covariance generating function because by partial differentiation and then evaluation at zero, then we can recapture the original covariance between Tx and Ty. Okay. So I think I don't have time for the second application. What I try to show today is to hopefully I can convince you that Hopkins lemma is a It is not very widely known, okay, but it is a good secret weapon that will be of theoretical and practical importance. Obviously, the time is not correct. I also think we don't have time for questions, but if you have any questions, feel free to discuss with me during the break. Okay, thank you very much.